Welcome back. Now that we know the basics of video, let's take a look at wiring the NV32H in the Q-SYS Designer software.
As always, we recommend that you follow along as you watch, even if you don't have any hardware. So,
come with me if you want to live.
We'll start by going to the inventory panel and selecting the Video tab. You'll find the NV32H near the top, and let's click twice to add two of them to our design. We're going to simulate a basic setup in which we have three HDMI sources in one room, and we'll deliver those to a single HDMI display in another room. These sources and displays are represented by these items, generic HDMI display and generic HDMI source in the software. So let's add those to our design too. We don't care what manufacturer or model these devices are, we just need something in the schematic to represent those devices.
However, a nice benefit to having these devices in your inventory is that their statuses can be delivered to Q-SYS Reflect Enterprise Manager. So, you can get all the information of these sources and displays from your cloud-based monitoring system. Pretty neat, right?
Like any Q-SYS network peripheral, you'd want to make sure you give this inventory item the same name as an actual device that's connected to your network. If you're emulating this without hardware, then obviously you can't do this right now. But I'll use the Q-SYS configurator to find my devices on the network and name them appropriately in my inventory properties. And don't forget to do your good housekeeping and give all your items a location name. And particularly for your HDMI components, you may want to label them so you know what they represent. Mine will represent a rack mount PC, a laptop, and a Blu-ray player for the sources, and a projector for the display. Once everything is named and organized, you have a very important task for your NV32Hs. By default, they start as encoders. So be sure to look at the properties and change the device type to decoder for any devices you're using in this manner. For me, I have one encoder and one decoder. Now, let's drag the most pertinent components of each item into our design so we can wire them together. Your generic HDMI devices only have a single status control block, so we'll grab each of these. The NV32Hs have an HDMI I/O encoder or HDMI I/O decoder component, so drag these into your schematic as well. You'll notice some new pin types you might have not seen before. The HDMI pin obviously represents a local HDMI port, while this other pin represents the encoded stream that goes across the network between two endpoints. So we'll call this an AV port, since it contains both the audio and video in the stream, and because the icon kind of looks like an A and a V that got fused together at their corners. However, rest assured that the HDMI pins also carry both video and audio. You'll notice that the decoders have an HDMI pin as well as audio pins. But these audio pins can be sent to the core for routing and processing, especially if you're using local reinforcements. These audio pins automatically follow the selected video, so there's no need to write any extra control logic for that. But if you're not reinforcing this audio with other loudspeakers, you don't need to wire these pins to your display component at all. We'll talk more about breaking audio away from the HDMI streams in a later video.
Before you wire anything together, I want to point out that if you open these components' control panels right now, there's very little inside. In fact, the decoder even tells you that it's useless because there's no displays wired to it.
So let's wire them up. Wire your three HDMI sources to your encoder's local HDMI inputs.
Don't forget that these generic components in Designer are just dummy blocks. If you physically wire the Blu-ray player into port 1, but you label it PC here in the software, you could get very confused later when you try to troubleshoot.
To make the connection between the encoder and the decoder, you could wire these AV pins to each other, but I'm going to recommend that you use signal tags for this. It's important to note as you do this that on the encoder side, there is a direct one-to-one correlation of the HDMI inputs to the AV streams. HDMI input 1 will always go to AV output stream 1. HDMI input 2 will always go to AV output stream 2. And HDMI input 3 will always go to AV output stream 3. However, Once they're encoded on the network, you can deliver them to a decoder in any order you like. Also note that the decoder has a default of 3 AV inputs, which in my small example is perfect. But if you have lots of video streams on the network, don't worry, you're not limited to only 3 options. Simply select the decoder and look at its properties and adjust the AV input count field. This lets you add a lot more options for your encoded AV sources to select for your decoder's outputs. Finally, wire your decoder's HDMI outputs to your HDMI display. Once this is wired up, the last and most important controls you'll want to know about are here inside the decoder's control panel. These are the routing options for your displays. Most installers will simply drag and drop these buttons into your UCI to give the user the ability to do some simple switching. That's definitely the easiest route. However, you can get pretty crafty here if you know a little Q-SYS scripting. By the way, you probably noticed that there are more input options than you probably expected. The first 3 options, labeled graphics 1-3, will display one of the 3 static images that you can upload using the Core Manager, which are useful for displaying color test patterns, business logos, or standby screens. You can also select any of the 3 local, non-encoded HDMI sources of the decoder units, if you have any sources located near this device. Finally, your encoded AV streams are listed at the end. If you're curious why they're listed last, even though they seem like the most commonly used buttons, well, I'll tell you. The graphics and local HDMI sources are fixed at 3 each, but you can customize the number of AV streams. This means that you can add a new AV stream later without breaking any logic you've built for activating the graphics or the HDMI sources.
If you're following along with real hardware, congratulations, you currently have a functioning design. Your media enters Q-SYS through an HDMI port on the encoder, and you can select to display that content across the network with the decoder. However, this was a very simple scenario. In the next few videos, we'll get very complicated and show you multiple displays and different source types and breaking away the audio from the HDMI streams.
One final feature I do want to show you is that you might have noticed a label called USB bridging in the NV32H's properties panel. In addition to managing HDMI video streams, NV Series doubles as a bridge for Q-SYS conference camera video and audio for use with soft codec conferencing applications like Microsoft Teams, Zoom, GoToMeeting, etc.
This eliminates the need for an additional Q-SYS bridging endpoint device that needs to live at the table. Less costs and less hardware. But don't get confused into thinking that you can route HDMI streams into the USB bridge. At this point, these are 2 separate functions. They are not compatible, and it's not a tumor.
If you want to learn more about USB audio and camera video bridging, we have a different tutorial for that.
All right, let's take a quick break and come back whenever you're ready.